These carburetors found on many different small engines are hiding a secret that so few mechanics know about, yet cause a huge amount of frustration and expense when trying to fix. If your engine is more than a few years old, it's hard to start, it doesn't run, or if it does, it's constantly bogging, the purge bulb, if present, doesn't fill up fully or even at all, and there are three drillings on the carburetor manifold, there's a very good chance that I'll resolve your issue in today's video. These cube-type carburetors are incredible pieces of engineering. They fit a wide range of machines and offer excellent running characteristics. However, one challenge they face is on acceleration, where air can quickly enter the engine due to its low mass. But the fuel, being sluggish in comparison, because it has to first be set in motion by the vacuum of the engine, causes what is known as poor off-idle acceleration, and it presents itself as either a bog or dip in revs whenever you actuate that throttle. Now, one way to overcome this is to set the low speed screw rich. This means that at idle, you're giving the engine more fuel than what it really needs. However, when you do actuate the throttle, it has the fuel available, so it eliminates that bog and that dip that we've just mentioned. However, like anything, there are always downsides. Of course, it's going to use more fuel, it creates more emissions, and in some instances, when you're turning the engine on its side, it can cause it to stall. So the way engineers have overcome this issue is using what is known as an accelerator pump. This is a small piston that moves fuel into the throat of the carburetor anytime you touch the accelerator. And it allows you to set the engine leaner at idle, which of course will reduce emissions. It reduces fuel consumption and you still get good off-idle acceleration. And when this system works, it's fantastic. However, it relies on one very tiny little O-ring. It's essential that the metering side of the carburetor is under vacuum at all times. This is so the diaphragm can be drawn down to fill up the metering chamber when needed. And if there is an air leak, the whole system will fail. Fuel won't be effectively drawn into that metering chamber and therefore in the engine, and it'll end up either not running or, if it does, very poorly at best. And because that piston is constantly in motion every time you touch that trigger, eventually it wears. And sometimes it can be as soon as just a few years, and that's when it needs to be replaced. Your purge bulb will gradually stop filling up with fuel. The engine becomes hard to start. If it does start, it will run very poorly. It will often stall constantly, and sometimes it can cause the engine to run rich, and other times even run lean. Therefore, being able to diagnose this symptom can be incredibly tricky, frustrating, and cause a lot of expense trying to find it. An excellent way to diagnose whether the accelerator pump has failed is to find the third hole on the intake manifold side of that carburetor, fill it up with some two-stroke oil, and then pump that purge bulb. If you find that the purge bulb fills up more than it was doing before, you know that the O-ring has failed. And this tip was shared with me by a follower, and I wish I could remember who, but just know that I do really appreciate it. And nowadays, mechanics rarely diagnose issues like this. If they suspect the carburetor is the issue, it's often much cheaper for the customer in the long run to just have the whole carburetor replaced. However, for a homeowner though, replacing that O-ring is quick, it's easy to do, and you only need a couple of different tools. Now, before disassembling the carburetor, I highly recommend you take a number of different photographs of the spring, the linkage, how the butterfly sits on the shaft, and any other parts of the carburetor that may aid in reassembly in a minute. And I can't stress enough, it's so important that you follow this process step by step like I'm going to show you. Don't skip or change the order, because you're only going to end up causing more problems than you're going to solve. Now, there is one tool that I highly recommend you use, not just for this repair, but any time you're working on carburetors. And that is a JIS, a Japanese industrial standard screwdriver. Now, the hardware between a Phillips and a JIS look very similar, as do the screwdrivers themselves. But if you use a Phillips head screwdriver on a JIS hardware, there's a very good chance that you'll strip that screw head out. And one really quick way to tell whether the hardware is JIS or not, if there is a dot present on the crown of the hardware, it indicates that it's a JIS, and therefore you use that screwdriver. And if there isn't a dot there, it indicates that it's a Phillips head screwdriver. And I've put a link in the description below if you want to buy yourself one. So the first step in this disassembly is to loosen the idle speed screw completely so it's no longer touching the cam in which it normally rests against, and then remove the fuel pump cover completely. The next step is to remove the small JIS screw on the butterfly holding it to the throttle shaft. Next, take a piece of thread, which will tie around the leg of the throttle spring and then around the cam too. And this keeps tension on the spring and saves a lot of frustration later, making reassembly a breeze. Now we'll put pressure on that throttle shaft to give us clearance to remove the E-clip on the other side. Now place your thumb over that third hole that we put oil on earlier, and you can gently rotate and pull the throttle shaft out completely. And it's really important that you keep your thumb covered the whole time, because if not, that piston will fly right out. Once the throttle shaft is completely removed, gently tap the carburetor onto a firm surface, and out will come, if it hasn't already, the piston, the spring, and a small screen as well. Here we can inspect that piston for excessive wear and the bore in which it rides in too. You can buy the piston kit as a whole assembly if it has notable wear, or more likely, just replacing the O-ring will suffice. To get the correct replacement parts, look on the side of the carburetor and you'll see the model and code, and often it's made up of a combination of numbers and letters. And from there you can type this into Google and you can select the parts list. And here you'll find the part numbers you're after, and you can purchase them either online or through your small engine repair shop. To reinstall these parts, we first add a little bit of oil to the groove on the piston and on the O-ring as well. Now you can install the small screen, and a pick is really handy here. It just allows you to locate that screen correctly. The spring goes next, and then lastly that piston. Just make sure that if it looks the same on both sides, that you orient it just how it came out. Oftentimes there's going to be wear marks on there, and you can match those up either with the throttle shaft or the spring too. Before you add the throttle shaft next, just put a little bit of oil into both the bore on the carburetor as well as the shaft itself. And then using that pick again, gently press down on that piston to compress the spring, and the shaft can then slip all the way in. Now we can secure that shaft and stop it coming out by using that E-clip at the other end. Again, a small amount of pressure on that shaft will give you the clearance that you need, and that fuel pump cover with the idle screw can go on next. From here, we can gently align and place that butterfly back into the bore of the carburetor. Now it's really important that you don't try and push or force it in. Gently lay it down, tap the base of the carburetor, and it will seat itself back home. These carburetor bores aren't actually round, they're slightly oval. So any time you try and push and force that butterfly in is going to ultimately result in damage to both the bore and the butterfly too. From here you can install that screw to hold the butterfly in place. Use a small amount of Loctite, but don't secure it all the way. Leave it just slightly loose so that butterfly has a little bit of movement. Undo the thread next to release that spring, and then again using that pick, just gently locate it back in place. Don't force or bend anything here, because you will affect that tension. And now that shaft and butterfly is back under tension, snap that linkage just a few times, and that's going to aid in seating the butterfly correctly in the bore, and then snug up that screw all the way. To ensure you've installed that butterfly correctly, use a flashlight on the other side of the carburetor. Shine it through the bore and just double check that you can't see any light on the circumference of the butterfly. If there is, loosen that screw, readjust it, tighten it back down, and check again. This is really important to ensure that you've got full adjustability and control over the idle speed. Now the last step is to turn the idle screw in until it touches the cam in which it rests against, and then do one more full turn. And this is a great starting place. You might need to adjust it when the engine's warm and when you're tuning it, but at least the engine will start and it will idle. And now install the carburetor back onto the engine, fit the fuel line and the return line, and pump the purge, and it should now fill up completely. Of course, start the engine, make sure it runs well, and it might require a small carburetor adjustment because we've now fixed the leak that we did have. And in the unlikely event that this hasn't resolved the issue that you were having, I've got this video here which covers the other areas that these carburetors can leak and how to fix them.